chapters 8 and 9. If you have a Bible you want to turn over there, I just want to read a scripture and then have a prayer. It says, 2 Corinthians 8 and 9, it says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich." Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for all those that are here today. And I know, Father, there are others that could not make it, that wanted to be here. I just pray, Father, that the things that we think about, the things that we do and say, and just will be pleasing in your sight, Father, that our hearts will be in tune with you. Father, as we remember what Jesus has done for us, what he was willing to sacrifice for us, and what we are willing to sacrifice for others, we pray, Father, that there will be a great outpouring of generosity, and that many, many will be helped through it, Father, that they will know that you love them, and that we love them, Father, that Jesus is our Lord and Savior, and we want him to be their Lord and Savior. Father, please, again, we just ask your blessings upon this service that we have. In Jesus' name, amen. So, as Willie said, we've been preparing for this a long time. Been a few months, and my wife finally told me Wednesday night, she said, "Enough. Stop teaching on this. You've worn it out." And I was going to teach on it this morning. She said, "No, Jim, you've taught enough. Give it to God. Let it go." And so even though I let it go, God led me right back to it. I don't know, you know. So this morning in Proverbs, we were studying the fear of the Lord. And there's a scripture in Deuteronomy that talks about the fear of the Lord. If I can find it. I know it's in here. Oh, well. I can't find it. But what it mentions right in the text of the need to fear the Lord is it says, "For the Lord loves the fatherless and the widows and the foreigners, and my people will take care of them." And that's really what this is all about today. This is all about helping the poor and the fatherless. And we help widows with this too, and other poor people. And I was just thinking about the past four or five times we've had Orphan Sunday, how worried I was that we were not going to be able to continue raising a lot of money. COVID set in. Lost a lot of members, and you guys have come through every time. And I can't tell you how, I can tell you, I'm so very proud of you. So very proud of this church. I boast about it to everybody. And we made the trip up to Eureka, the invitation to tell them about our journey with Orphan Sunday. And they're having Orphan Sunday today for the first time. And had just a great reception. And they're excited about it. And I can't wait to see that grow over the next few years the way it did with us. I was showing them how, I think it was 14 years ago, was our first Orphan Sunday. We were going to take a mission trip to Antigua. And we had raised some money and we were all set to go, and then they had a swine flu outbreak. And so they kind of shut the island down, didn't want tourists to come there, and the church church said this wouldn't be a good time to come. So we had this 15 grand sitting in the general fund of the church and said, man, we need to use that for something. And we got this flyer in the mail from Orphans Lifeline of Hope. And I thought, well, that'd be a great work. And so we looked into that, and we sent them $15,000 that year. And I remember the response that we got from them. They were so excited that we were participating in it. And then I thought, well, you know what? I'm gonna do this next year. And so we did it the following year, and I think it was like $21,000 that we raised. And ever since then, it has just snowballed. I think about the fourth year that we did it, we got together and said, well, listen, why don't we match whatever everybody gives, we'll match it with the general fund of the church. And so we started doubling it, and then it was 56,000, and then 64,000, and then 80,000, and then 100,000, and then 117,000, and it just has snowballed almost out of control. And every year I'm like, I'm so worried. And I'm not worried that, you know, it'll be a letdown for me. I'm worried about those organizations that we help and the work that they do, and I'm worried about them, you know. I'm thinking, gosh, they depend on us now. They really do depend on us. There's one organization that raises several million dollars every year to go towards their different works, and they have wonderful works. They told me that we are the biggest donor out of all the hundreds, maybe thousands of churches that give to them. We are the largest donors. And he asked me, he said, are you guys a mega church? I said, yeah, we're mega small. I mean, look at this. And so, you know, it's just, it's a God thing. It really is. It's God working in the hearts of people. And so over the last couple of months, we've been studying about giving, and we've talked about, you know, God's desire for us. We've talked about tithing, and this is not about tithing this morning. It's about something much greater than that. And really what I want to end this series of all these lessons I've been teaching on giving and helping the poor and looking out for orphans and widows is how we need to transform our minds into being cheerful givers. From being stressed out givers, from being reluctant givers, from being, you know, cheerful givers that look forward to it and are happy to do it. And that's what I want to end on this morning. There's a passage in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 7 and 8 that says, each man should give whatever he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. I love those verses. When Paul wrote that, he was speaking of a specific collection. It was a special collection. It wasn't their weekly contribution, although he did encourage them to set aside an amount every week so that he wouldn't have to go around and gather all the money up at the last moment. But he was talking about a very special collection, and it was to help the poor Christians in Jerusalem. And this particular offering is talked about several times in Scripture. We're first introduced to it in Acts chapter 11. And it says in verses 27 through 30, during this time, some prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch. One of them named Agabus stood up and through the Spirit predicted that a severe famine would spread over the entire Roman world. This happened during the reign of Claudius. The disciples, as each one was able, decided to provide help for the brothers and sisters living in Judea. This they did, sending their gift to the elders by Barnabas and Saul. Again, in Romans 15, verses 25 and 26, Paul, writing to the church in Rome, he says, "Now, however, I am on my way to Jerusalem in the service of the Lord's people there, for Macedonia and Achaia were pleased to make a contribution for the poor among the Lord's people in Jerusalem." In 1 Corinthians 16, verses 1 through 4, which is a verse that sometimes we use to encourage giving weekly, but he was talking about this collection. "Now about the collection for the Lord's people. Do what I told the Galatian churches to do. On the first day of the week, every week, each one should set aside a sum of money in keeping with your income, saving it up so that when I come, no collections will have to be made. Then when I arrive, I will give letters of an introduction to the men you approve and send them with your gift to Jerusalem. If it seems advisable for me to go, I will go and accompany them." So this was a special collection for the Christians in Judea who had been enduring and suffering from a very severe drought and famine. And God's people, all that were able to, gave as much as they could give. And of course, we've read this, this passage in 2 Corinthians 8, verses 1 through 4 so many times, you probably have it memorized. "And now, brothers, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches." Keep in mind, he's writing to the church in Corinth. And he's telling them about what the churches in Macedonia had done already. And he's trying to inspire them to be even more generous. And so he says, I want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. "Out of the most severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity." Those words don't go together. That doesn't make sense. Severe trial. They, in Macedonia, were undergoing a severe trial. He says, but their overflowing joy, their happiness to do this, and their extreme poverty. Remember, extreme poverty means that they are deficient of basic human necessities. Food, water, shelter, those kinds of things. Extreme poverty, welled up, all these things put together, welled up in rich generosity. "For I testify that they gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability." And I always say, how did they do that? They gave all they were able to give. How did they go beyond their... Did they take out a loan? "Entirely on their own, they urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in the service to the saints. And they did not do as we expected, but they gave themselves first to the Lord and then to us in keeping with God's will." I think they urgently pleaded with us. That leads me to just assume that Paul was saying, you can't afford it, man. You guys are going through your own trials. You got your own problems. You can't afford to give all this money. We want to give it. We want to give it. And he says, they didn't do as we expected. And I'm assuming this. Paul expected them to, throw in the two small, very small copper coins like the widow, the poor widow at the temple, to throw in a couple small coins, and he would have been pleased with that. But they poured out their generosity. And he said that this is the reason why. For they gave themselves first to the Lord and then to us in keeping with God's will. So this is a special collection for a specific purpose, and that was to help these poor Christians in Judea who were suffering from a famine. And Paul writes to the Corinthian church, and he's encouraging them to have that same spirit. He uses the Macedonian church as an example, and he says, be like them. Be like them. This collection today is a special collection. It's above and beyond the generous giving that you already do. I mean, we have surplus in our general fund from this little church. You already give generously. And I know that you do it because you love God, and you know that His will is for you to give towards His cause and His work. And this isn't just, it's a side thing. It's above and beyond what you normally give. But it's for a good cause. And it's for the cause that we know is close to the heart of God. That God cares for the vulnerable. And it's difficult for us to really relate to it. I mean, we see homeless people sometimes that are dirty and look terrible, and our heart goes out for them, and we think, oh, that's so sad. But we don't really see what poverty looks like in some of these third world countries. At least most of us don't. It's ugly. It's pathetic. And 99.9% of all this money is going to that kind of people. Here in the States, I mean, I know there's some good works here in the States, but here in the States, there are safety nets and all kinds of programs to help the poor and to look out for the fatherless and all those things. They're cared for here in the States. But they don't have those things in a lot of places in Africa or Russia or Haiti or China. And so we target these poor, poor orphan children. Most of these children were born into poverty. No fault of their own. And you realize that two-thirds of the world's poor is made up by children. Two-thirds. There's a statistic that 22,000 children die every day from preventable causes related to extreme poverty. From not having clean water. And we've witnessed this. We've been to Uganda and Mexico, and we've seen it firsthand. The first time we went to Uganda and with Penny, I remember going to the school. We were going to help build the school. And at the school, they had this, it was about a 10 by 10 round ditch full of dirty water. And while we were there, the kids were bringing their 5-gallon buckets and dipping it in there and taking it home. That was their water. And all around there, there were goats and cows and cow dung everywhere. And you can only imagine, this is how kids get malaria and all kinds of other diseases and dysentery. And 22,000 die every day. You know how many people live in Encinitas? I think it's 62,000. Might be 66 now, I don't know. 3 days, this place would be wiped out. That's how many kids die every single day. From preventable causes. If just someone would help a little. And that's what we do. And that's what we're involved in. These kids lack some of the most basic human needs. Clean water. Health care. Mosquito nets. Education. Most of the kids, they work in the fields to support their families. They don't even go to school. We take them and pay their way to school. A lot of us sponsor children. I think we as a church sponsor 14 through the Christian Relief Fund, but many more of you sponsor individuals. The last time we went, we decided we were going to start taking these kids out of Kampala slums. We went and visited the slums in Kampala. Just disgusting. Just unbelievable. They had a little ditch running down the middle of the village. Sewer. That was their sewer. Open ditch. They had a fish market that was just so full of flies and who knows what else. So we decided we were going to start pulling some kids out of the slums in Kampala, taking them to Bujiri, where we're building another school with Florence for Youth in Action, and give them an education alongside rich kids who pay for this kind of boarding school, whose rich parents are able to get them the best education they can have, and we're putting those kids right in there with them, buying them uniforms so that nobody knows the difference. That's what this is all about. We're trying to help lift them up out of poverty, give them an opportunity in life. And in doing this, we're trying to show them the love of God. We're trying to say, look, we're here because God cares for you, and we want to help you. And hopefully, you know, all the organizations that we work with are Christian organizations, and they teach them about Jesus, and they teach them the Bible, and hopefully these kids will grow up and become Christians. And some of them have, and some of them have become preachers. This is an awesome work. And we know that this is the will of God. We know that it's God's heart. He said, pure religion, undefiled before God is this. Not to go to church every week or get baptized or to look after orphans and widows in their distress and keep oneself from being polluted by the world. You know what how the world pollutes us? With greed, and selfishness. And we're just not going to have it here, are we? This is a wonderful work. It's a special collection. The one that the Macedonian church and the churches in Achaia and Corinth and all around, it was completely voluntary. In other words, they did this willingly. It wasn't like they were required to. In fact, Paul even says in verse 8 of chapter 8, I am not commanding you. I'm not commanding you. This isn't required. If you don't want to do this, that is perfectly your choice. The amount they give, it was entirely their decision. He didn't say, listen, you guys can all give at least a tenth. He didn't say that. He said, you decide in your heart what to give. It's completely up to you. I think our church has just demonstrated that we have always been eager to give to help those in need. In so many ways. And that's exactly what God loves. Not reluctantly, he said. Don't do this reluctantly. In other words, they didn't give because they were guilted into it. Oh, I hope you don't feel guilted into it. If you felt a little conviction in the lessons that I taught, that's okay. Sometimes we need to feel that. Need to be reminded of how rich we are. We need to be reminded what God's will is for us. But I am definitely not wanting you to give because you feel guilted into it. They didn't do it because they were worried about what others might think. Jim knows how rich I am, so if I don't give a big hunk of money, then he's going to think I'm chintzy. Cheap. No. Nobody's judging anybody here. This is between you and God, and you know, this is something you decide for yourself. I got to tell you, Satan's been working on me. You know, we did a little lesson about how hard it is sometimes to wrestle with being generous. That we think, well, how much can I really give? And I'm telling you, come on, let's give more than we gave last year. You know, I gave a lot last year. Just 2 cents more. No, that's not what I meant, Willie. And how hard that is. You know, you're, last year I was able to sell my Harley and use that money. But I didn't have a Harley this year. So I'm wrestling with it, and you know, I'm thinking to myself, you know what? This is silly. I'm going to give this amount. And I sat down and with a joyful heart wrote my check. Folded it up, put it in my wallet. That was a couple weeks ago. And then, yesterday. Now, you tell me if this isn't Satan. Yesterday, we got our first bills for Kim's visit to the hospital, the emergency room. They ain't cheap. And I'm thinking, I'm looking at those bills, and I'm going, whoa, whoa. And I'm thinking, maybe I should write a new check. Deduct the doctor bills. No, really, I'm just being honest with you. That's how. And then it was like, stop it.
The hand of God.
And that was the end of it. That was the end of it, and no more struggles. It's done deal. I'm there, 100%, 110%. Look, this is completely voluntary. Don't feel compelled to participate in this. You don't have to. Don't do it if you're like struggling with it. It's okay to struggle with it, but. But once you've done it, let go of it. Let go of it. Don't look back. I had a guy leave this church once after several years of being here. And the last words he said to me was, well, I wish I had all the money back that I gave to this church. I'm thinking to myself, well, I wish I could write you a check right now. If you didn't feel good about giving it, don't give it. This was to be a cheerful giving. It was a feel-good gift. Those are my words, but it feels good to express our love for God by doing what pleases Him. It feels good when we finally get to that resolve, you know, we're content. We're there. We're where we need to be, and we're doing it completely out of our love for God. Completely. And I think we're there. I think you guys are there, and we're doing that. And I think about how the last time we went to Uganda, we were at one of the schools that we had helped build, and we drove up early in the morning, and the children come running up to us. This was typical, but they came running up to us with their shirts up like this, full of fruit, apples and mangoes and bananas, and they run up and they fall down before us on their knees, and I'm like, get up, don't do that. And they're like almost worshiping us, and I'm saying, well, don't stop, you know. And they had brought us gifts. And I was like, I mean, that was the spirit of the Macedonian church. Out of that extreme poverty, this rich generosity welled up in them. It's amazing. Sometimes the poorest people are the most generous people. It feels good also to express our love for our neighbor by helping them when they're in need. I mean, you know, when you see those kids and you see their conditions, and then you're thinking, you know, I'm helping them. I'm lifting them up. It feels good. It really does. It's a warm, fuzzy feeling. It's a good feeling. And when we do this, we're fulfilling the two greatest commandments there is. This is our purpose as a church. This is our mission statement. To love God with all of our hearts and souls and mind and strength. And to love our neighbors as ourselves. And when we love our neighbors as ourselves, we're showing God that we love Him and that we have the same values as He does. This is a beautiful thing, and it feels good to be involved in this. It should be something that we're happy to do, not something that we struggle to do. There's nothing more rewarding than helping the poor, and especially poor children, and that's what we're doing. You know, I've talked about this a lot, but we are over the top blessed. I mean, we are the top 1% of wage earners in the entire world. If your household makes $60,000 a year, you're at the top 1% of all wage earners in the entire world. You are at the top, the very top. But we think $60,000, how does anyone live on that? Do you know what it costs in California to live? Well, you can thank Governor Newsom for that. No, I shouldn't have said that. I take it back. We are so blessed, but we always compare ourselves with people more blessed than us. That's where we get in trouble. That's when we start feeling sorry for it. That's when we start envying. That's when we start being greedy. And we don't need to compare ourselves with anyone. We are rich. It's just true. We're rich. this is one way that we can say, God, and you've blessed my life so richly. I want to show you that I really appreciate it. I am truly grateful. And I know that all you would ask me to do is pay it forward. To take some of what you've given me and give it to someone else who needs it. That's what we're doing today. And I'm telling you, it's a happy thing. It's a blessing to be able to do this. This is the kind of giver that God loves. He loves when we give our hearts to Him and we give from our hearts. He loves to see our compassion. You know, as a father, some of the proudest moments of my life were when my children shared with other kids. When we were in Antigua, we lived in the third world country. We would have members of the church and families come over to our house. We'd fix them a meal, and usually they'd bring about 10 other family members that we knew nothing about. But that was all right. And when we would invite little children, our children's ages, we would pull all their toys out into the front room and you know, put them in a pile out there. And I've told you this story before, but this touched my heart. Little Troy, who's the same age as my oldest son, Michael, he came into the house, he saw that pile of toys, and the rest of the day, he would run and grab a toy, take it over to the corner, set it down, look at that pile, run back over, grab another toy, take it over, put it in the corner, run back over, grab another. That's all he did. He never played with any of them. It was like, this guy just hit a gold mine, and he was going to get every nugget out of there he could. And I remember Michael sitting there. I think he was a little over 2 years old, so he wasn't, you know, I don't think he knew what he meant. He knew what he was doing because mom and dad had taught him this. But he saw what Troy was doing. And so Troy would run over and he'd hand him another one. And then he'd grab a couple and he'd walk over and throw it into the corner for him. And it was just, I was just watching that going, that's my son. I'm so proud of him. I'm sure he didn't understand the difference between himself and Troy yet. But to see him, you know, showing that love. God loves to see our willingness to sacrifice. You know, we talked about the poor widow who gave her two very small copper coins that were worth only a fraction of a penny. Jesus singled her out, said she gave more than all the rest of them, because they gave out of their abundance, their wealth, but she gave out of her poverty everything, all she had to live on. And Jesus looked at her with great joy and pride. And that's the way Paul looked at the Macedonian church. He was blown away by it, and all he wanted to do is tell everybody about it. And that's the way I feel. You should have seen me in Eureka. Standing before that church and just being able to say, look what we've done. And I'm not in an arrogant way or anything like that. My prayer was that, Lord, use me to inspire them to get involved. And we did. He loves to see our desire to do His will. That even though we're not perfect, we're always striving to do the things that we know we should do. And we're happy to do that because we love God and we appreciate what he does for us. And that desire means a lot to God. This is the kind of heart that he loves. And this is the kind of heart that God blesses. There's a proverb that says something like, he who scatters seed in abundance reaps even more. But he who sows little, even what he has is taken from him. And that's a true principle, that sowing and reaping principle that we read about in the Bible. In this passage that we were looking at this morning in chapter 9, in verse 8, it says, after he talks about each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. Okay, Doug asked me before church if I was worried. Because he knows me. He knows that every Orphan Sunday I'm wringing my hands and thinking, last year, I think there were like 10 people here when services were about ready to start, and I was like, oh no. And then by the time we started, the place started filling up, and there was a whole bunch of people here, and it ended up being more than we had given the year before. And so I told him, I said, now, you know, I'm not worried this morning. Done all I can do and prayed about it, and it's in God's hands now. Do you have a number for me? Huh?
You want the number?
If you don't mind.
99,398.
Wow. 99,000. Not bad. Not bad. Fantastic, isn't it? So what God does is he blesses us with more resources so that we can be successful in our work. Notice he says there, you will abound in every good work. And he will bless us with many more opportunities. So this is a special collection.